First song that we're going to sing, your personal prayer to the Lord as we begin. in our time of worship. Prayer requests or needs that you have on our Facebook page. Also, be sure and subscribe to our Instagram and YouTube channels so that you're kept up to date with all that is going on here at FBC Wayne. Brother Rick is continuing a Bible-based series about the imminent return of Christ to the earth with his message this morning entitled, A Day of Reckoning is Coming. Sounds foreboding, doesn't it? Pray for him when he stands to deliver this. this message in just a few minutes. And of course, the Bible says that we shouldn't be worried about knowing the date of the Lord's return for His bride, the church, but to always live as if it could be today. In the same manner, James Neal is eagerly anticipating claiming his bride right here on Saturday, October the 3rd at 2 p.m., Lord willing. Again, you don't want to know what's going on behind that hat. But, of course, keep them in your prayers as they continue to plan and prepare. We are now less than 2 weeks away from
the Day of Reckoning.
The Day of Reckoning. Is that the Day of Reckoning you're talking about, Rick?
The Day of Reckoning.
He just couldn't resist. I've heard this last Wednesday's meal was incredible once more with chicken and potatoes and gravy. And we are so grateful to those who are helping to make it happen. Every Wednesday we offer a free meal at 5:30 in the fellowship hall before Bible study begins at 6:30 for all ages. You see the menu up there on the screen. I was informed that we're in need of wieners and hot dog buns. The note I was handed said six each. Six each of what, Sharon?
Six packages of wieners and six packages of buns.
Okay. I should have asked for clarification when you handed this to me. That's okay. Let Sharon or Karen know today, please, if you can help with either one of those needs. And, of course, if you want to help by providing a dessert, let them know that as well. Brother Rick has started a study on the book of Romans each Wednesday evening. Belly food will be followed by spiritual grub. Best of both worlds. And I told Rick yesterday when I saw him that it was interesting he was starting a series on the book of Romans because there's a pastor that I like to read his works and listen to his sermons online by the name of John Piper, pastored up at Bethlehem Baptist Church in Minneapolis, Minnesota. He started a sermon series on the book of Romans, took him 10 years. So buckle up. So much in that book. The food pantry is going to be open again this coming Saturday, the 26th, from 11 to 1, still curbside delivery only. They are in need of a lot of items, and there are lists on the table there out in the fellowship hall. Be sure to pick one up, and if you can help them out with some of those needs, it would be greatly appreciated. Or, of course, you can always donate monetarily, and they can get the items that way. Much thanks to those of you still at home who have been faithful to send in your tithes and offerings either by mail or through the church website. And for those of you that are here this morning, the offering plate is in its usual spot to the back behind Earl and Robin McGee back there. And of course, again, we ask that when possible, if you have prayer requests, I ask that you turn them in before the service starts to either myself or Pastor Rick. And speaking of prayer requests, we have a few to mention. Bill Boggess says you heard from the flock note this week. He was in the hospital again with a bout of pneumonia. He is back home and tuning in this morning. So, Bill, wherever you're watching from, hello. And we look forward to the time when you can be back with us in person very soon. Philip and Phyllis Webster are in serious need of prayer as Phyllis is pretty much stuck in bed right now. And Philip isn't in the best of health either, so pray for both of them. Continue to pray for Jack Morrison, Rose Payne, Mary Sue Penner. Pray for Carrie Taylor's family, especially her father, for Jessica DeBates, who's been dealing with some health issues here lately, and for our nation. Of course, continue to pray for our healthcare workers, school employees, people like that who are on the front lines of the battle against COVID-19. And so at this time, I'm going to call on Jim Paddock, if he would, to take us to the throne.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the way that you blessed us. We thank you, Lord, for our church. Lord, I do pray for all of these names that have been mentioned this morning, Lord, each with their individual situations. Lord, we pray that you'd be close to each one of them. We pray for healings. We pray, Lord, most of all, that they know that you are with them and that you are in their plans. Lord, we pray for our country. We pray, Lord, about this virus. We pray, Lord, that you'd be with those on the front lines, Lord, that all of our health care workers. Lord, mainly we pray for our leaders of our country, Lord, as they make decisions concerning this and other things, Lord. I pray for those that follow you, that know you as their Savior, Lord, that you will lead them in their decisions. We pray, Lord, for revival for our country. We pray, Lord, that we would come back to you. Pray, Lord, for Brother Rick as he delivers this important message this morning, that you will greatly bless it as it goes out, Lord, that we would receive it and again, Lord, we thank you for your free gift of salvation. And I pray that anyone listening to the service this morning, Lord, doesn't know you as Savior, that this would be the day that they would trust you as their Savior. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We'd ask you all to stand with us as we continue our time of worship this morning.
Fresh from the word, sweet a rain. If tomorrow all the things were gone I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife,
I'd thank my God above to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away.
Now, when the national anthem is actually played, I'm not going to ask you to rise for that. The point is, watch the video and watch the reactions.
There is right and there is wrong. And I say, well done, Coach Williams. He led, he taught by example. He didn't let things get out of hand. He just immediately addressed the situation. He saw his young men making a serious mistake by disrespecting the flag and our national anthem. And many of them had fallen for a lie. Many of them may not have meant anything by it. But some folks believe something they heard without checking out the truth of the matter. And he sought to correct the mistake. Because there is right and there is wrong, and there are rewards for righteousness, and there are serious consequences for wrong behavior. And too many Americans, particularly young Americans, are listening to the wrong voices. Oh, these voices are loud and they're confident sounding, but they're wrong. And the Bible says, and I encourage you to take the Bible and to mark these places, because we're going to use a couple verses today. Maybe you haven't heard before, or you haven't heard in a long time, and you don't know where they're at. The Proverbs 18:17 says, the first to present his case seems right, till another comes forward and questions it. Till you've heard the other side. The lesson is, and history teaches us, not to always fall in with the first person who sounds like they know what they're talking about. Often proclaiming some horrible injustice has been done. Boy, anybody can make anything sound right if you tell just what you want to hear, if you edit it. Further investigation should always be made before just assuming that first voice is correct. Amen? I've counseled many people who want me to agree with their complaint. And you know what I do? I say, well, okay, I hear what you're saying. Now, if I was to have the other side in here, I'd probably hear a totally different side of the story, don't you think? And you know what? 100% of the time they say, yeah, you probably would. There's two sides, at least two sides. The Bible says in Proverbs 14:12, oh, there is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death. I know you're familiar with that passage. The Bible also says in Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed from lack of knowledge, from not checking things out, from not studying history. Sometimes I think it's amazing any of us survived our youth. I mean, many of us in this room, we can think back and go, wow, goodness. But for the grace of God and the prayers of some relatives, we may not have survived, and our day of reckoning may have already come upon us. You know, as parents, grandparents, teachers, pastors, you know, our job is to steer children and young people away from foolish paths that will lead to misery, regret, and even death. And I'm glad that coach did his part. You see, the day of reckoning, the day, capital D, is coming for all of us. The Bible says in Hebrews 9:27-28, just as man is destined to die once, and after that what? Face judgment. So Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. And he will appear a second time. He's coming back. And this time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. And you know what else is coming? Judgment for those who did not accept him. Salvation to those who did. There is right and there is wrong. And not enough Americans right now are living righteously, as if they actually believed the day of reckoning was really coming. Think about it. If they believe that daddy's coming home soon, doesn't that tend to modify behavior? Probably modify their actions by thinking about the consequences of their behavior. Aretha Franklin, many of you have heard of her, the great gospel artist, the rhythm and blues singer. As I was typing this out, I started thinking about that song that she made famous. You better think. I love that. Three-word title on that song, and she put that finger out there. You better think. I'm going to be honest with you, and some of you may not like it, but history is for our benefit. I loved history. I loved it. You know that. I've studied history. We are genuinely meant to learn from our past mistakes. History repeats itself over and over again, and Satan has found out, I can just keep throwing out the same tricks. I keep throwing out the same tricks, and they're going to fall for them. They're going to fall for them. Most folks are going to fall for them. It doesn't take a dumb animal long to recognize that electric fence is not to be messed with. They can figure that out. We refer to them as dumb animals, but how many humans living in this country cannot comprehend that a nation without fences or borders will cease to be a nation? Adolf Hitler capitalized on erasing borders and destroying national identities. Now, we just saw a wise coach teach his young players they better think about what they are doing in disrespecting their national anthem and our country's proud history. Because countless young people have fallen for the false narratives that are out there without carefully examining both sides to find out what those narratives really are. Too many American lives have been sacrificed for our freedoms to just disrespect these people and toss them away without a serious second thought about the consequences. I love that Coach brought that out. These men, these young men are getting to play under the freedoms that were bought by these men's service and sacrifice. I said some of you might not like this, and I know there are very few history teachers in our American school system today that that's all they teach. You listening to me? History is being rewritten. Things are being taken out. And there are very few history teachers that is all they teach. Many are coaches today that are also asked to teach history on the side. And I'll tell you what, a few do take that responsibility very seriously. Praise God for that. But many more do not. I've dealt with the issue in my own girls' school when they were growing up in Noble. A coach who handed out worksheets while he chewed tobacco and watched game film. Y'all do these worksheets. If everybody turns them in, I'll give y'all a B for the semester. How's that sound? Hey, some of the kids, that sounded great. You know, but Lindy was working on being valedictorian. A B wasn't going to cut it. So I went and did something about it. I told him, you better think. And then the superintendent told him, son, you better think. History should be taught like we teach the Bible, with passion. The Bible is his story. That's how I always want to look at it. Because too few of our elected officials are unfamiliar with even recent history. I'm talking about the history of the last century. We are doomed to repeat the mistakes of every other world empire that has come and gone. And no socialist nation has much history. Nothing to be proud of. They don't have a lengthy history. A socialist nation cannot tax its people into prosperity or give free health care and education without going bankrupt. The printing presses are not going to solve the problem. America is a republic. A lot of people don't even know what that is. We are? Yes. We're a republic where the people choose their government. And if the government displeases the people and doesn't do their job, what do the people do?
Vote them out.
Tell them you should have thought. We have a growing number of, doesn't this sound nice, progressives? Well, man, we all want to move forward. Progressive socialists. You know, is what they're calling themselves. People don't even know what that means. It sounds nice. But they want to change all that. They don't want it to be a republic anymore. And Americans unfamiliar with history are ready to walk that path. That failed path all over again in 1930. Think about this. I don't know if there's anybody here that was alive then. But in 1930, no one had ever heard of a national socialist. Nobody knew what that was. And 3 years later, Adolf Hitler, a national socialist, took complete absolute power in Germany. It used to be a democratic republic. They had votes, they had elections. Not after the National Socialists took power. He removed God. He was an antichrist figure. He removed all hope in God. He was their Führer. He was the leader. He was the one everybody looked to and worshiped. Sieg Heil, hail to the Führer. but people haven't studied history. A lot of people don't remember that. You've already got people that are, we've had people for 20 years denying that the Holocaust ever happened. I'm so grateful that General Eisenhower, whenever he found those concentration camps where all those Jews were being, and undesirables, the deplorables, were being taken care of and liquidated, that he brought in cameras. And he had it documented, all the places, everything. And he had the cameras showing the truth, the ugly truth, because he said, he knew, someday somebody's going to say, this never happened. I'm so grateful that he did it. We have people, even though we have the video proof, that are saying, oh, that never happened. You have people in the American government today that are trying to say that never happened. 3 years, no one knew what a National Socialist was, and then that whole nation became National Socialist. That's how quickly America is changing. That, you've heard me say it, and we might say, oh, yeah. We're only just one election away. One election away. That quick. 4 years ago, whenever I was preaching and teaching before the election, I said, I'll tell you what, if the election doesn't go a certain way, these things that I'm saying right now, I won't be able to say any longer without being in trouble. And I meant that, because it goes out. People can see it. And you know what? Some people are watching, and they're listening, and it can change that quickly. Hitler assumed power, absolute power. The people no longer had any vote or say in the matter. And what does it say? Absolute power corrupts absolutely. Hitler began gobbling up small countries all over Europe. And at the time, those who could have stopped him didn't understand what was happening, or they were trying to turn a blind eye. Sure, this just go away. Winston Churchill, who was a student of history, he saw Hitler for who he really was. And he started screaming, telling folks, don't let him get away with this. He was yelling at Parliament. He was telling the British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, this man is a murderer. He's going to cause a war. Stop him while we can. We cannot just let him keep steamrolling over everybody. But no one would listen. So the Prime Minister of Britain, Neville Chamberlain, he refused to stand up against Hitler as he made continual demands for more countries to be added to his empire. And Neville Chamberlain and different ones, they just kept appeasing him. Appeasing, just give him a little more and he'll stop. Oh, give him a little more. Just give him a little more. We don't want a war. Just let him have what he wants. We've had American presidents who sought to appease Iran with billions of dollars. Just give them money. Give them a little technology, and they'll be happy. We've given secret technology and even sent assistance, people to show them how to use it, to China. How's that appeasement worked out? History repeats itself. Those who fail to study it are doomed. Well, finally in Munich, Germany, in 1938, Hitler made one promise, another promise. He said, I won't seek any more land if you European leaders will just give me Czechoslovakia. Just give me that one more country. 15 million people. Hitler said, well, most of them speak German anyway. Just let them come back into my empire. 15 million people. Prime Minister Chamberlain, anxious to please, hoping maybe he'd get a Nobel Peace Prize, I don't know, handed over the checks to the Nazis for Hitler's promise of peace. He returned to England, waving the peace paper, going, look, peace in our time. And that was the headline in all of the English papers that next day. Peace in our time. If that isn't right out of the Bible, I don't know what is. Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 through 4, now brothers, about times and dates, we do not need to write you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord, that's God's judgment, is going to come like a thief in the night. That was said 7 times in Scripture. While people are saying, here it is, while people are saying, peace, safety, it's going to be okay, destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. And some folks, y'all know history. Y'all have studied it. Y'all have been looking at the Word. You've been hearing what I've been saying. You're not like the average person, right? pains on a pregnant woman. What did we say last week? Faster, they increase, faster, faster. What are we seeing in society today? The hits just keep coming. They can't get any worse. Faster, faster. 3 years ago, what was happening? Did we see this coming? All the things that are happening? No. I never heard that Ruth Bader Ginsburg passed away. I texted Jim and said, well, more gas on the fire. We gotta end this year. It's just, you know, flames, I don't know. You know, history proves the Bible is accurate, giving us as many smaller pictures. You see, smaller pictures. I talked to you about whenever Israel rebelled against the Roman rule in AD 70, and the whole city of Jerusalem, as Jesus prophesied, was wiped out. 1.1 million Jews slaughtered. As horrific event as that was, the city leveled, the temple annihilated, all of that. That was terrible, but it was a small picture of what the destruction of the world was going to be like. And that's what Jesus, he paralleled those two things together. When I come back, he's saying, that's going to pale in comparison to what's coming. In less than a year of Chamberlain waving peace in our time in the faces of the British people, Hitler plunged the entire planet into World War II, which led to the deaths, a conservative estimate, of 60 million people. Chamberlain resigned in disgrace. He quickly died, a broken man, within a year. England turned to guess who? Churchill, the one who'd been telling them from the start. They turned to him. He'd been trying to warn them from the beginning, and they made him prime minister. And now they're standing alone against the Nazi Empire. Churchill literally willed his tiny island nation to survive until America entered the war 2 years later. And the rest is history. History matters. Listen, 1 John 2:18, and then a couple verses following. The Bible says, "Dear children, this is the last hour," meaning the final age before Christ returns. "And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now," what? "Many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour. But you have an anointing from the Holy One." You, the ones he is writing to, you have an anointing from the Holy One. You know what he means? You have the Holy Spirit. You've trusted Christ. The Holy Spirit is in you, and he should be able to enlighten you. And part of what the Holy Spirit does is he will lead you into all truth. So you know what the truth is. He says, "I do not write to you because you do not know the truth, because you do know it, and because no lie comes from the truth." Who is the liar? It is the man who denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a man is the Antichrist. He denies the Father and the Son. Last week I shared with you 5 points that have recently become popular in Christian circles concerning the return of Christ. And one of the things we're told to hunt for is a figure we can point out as the Antichrist. You know, the Antichrist doesn't even have to be a person. It can be a system of government. It can be a form of government, which would be something like the Muslims. It could be, of course, a socialist government, a communist government. But we're told to hunt for a figure that we can point out as the Antichrist. And it could very well be. As John wrote, there have been many throughout history. The Greek general Antiochus Epiphanes IV, he desecrated the Jewish temple as early as 168 BC. The Roman Emperor Caligula, you've heard of him probably if you study history, he tried to do the same, proclaiming himself to be God, wanted to set up a statue of himself in the temple in Jerusalem, as did Nero. All of these were legitimate antichrists. And if you read the writings of Paul, you'll see he's pretty much talking about Nero. This is what socialism does. Marx, Lenin, Hitler, Stalin, Napoleon, Mussolini, Saddam Hussein, Kim Jong-un, just to name a few. Any absolute dictator throughout history who seeks to remove all hope in God, because you have to do that, you have to take the people's dependence upon a higher power other than myself, the government. Have to do that and replace it with themselves, and all these have been and will always be antichrists. And thankfully, all of them face their day of reckoning. All of them. Hear me. Instead of looking for a particular Antichrist and trying to calculate from there when Christ's going to return, we look to the one true God and live as if Christ could come at any time.
Amen.
Live righteously in the midst of unrighteousness. We can keep dreading the awful days of tribulation to come when Jesus has already told us in John 16:33 that in this life you will face tribulation. You're going to face suffering. And in this world, you're going to face it. But Jesus tells us not to worry, but to live in confidence. Keep your head in all situations, he says. Because he has already overcome the world. The conclusion is sealed. The outcome is certain. Hallelujah. Now to conclude, should the return of Christ be just a little further down the road, all of us are going to die. Should the Lord tarry a little bit longer, he's the one who's in control. He knows. Because I'll tell you, it can always get worse. All of us are going to die. There's nothing you can do about that. Your personal day of reckoning is going to arrive, and you are going to stand before the throne of Christ. Every single one of us in this room, we know that for certain. We are going to stand before the throne of Christ. But the outcome of that inevitable day can be altered by what you do today. Hallelujah, you're still living, you're still breathing. There's still something you can do. Do something with Jesus Christ today. As Winston Churchill did with Hitler, I have studied history in this book, and I have been sounding the alarm about our nation and our spiritual condition for some time. The question now is, like those young basketball players you saw, will you respond before it's too late? If you choose to listen and give your life to Jesus Christ right now, here or those of you watching, then you don't need to fear tomorrow. No matter what comes, it can get horrible, and it can always get worse, and it's probably going to get worse, but you don't have to worry about it. There is right and there is wrong. And because of the wrong choices Americans are now making out of willful ignorance, listening to the wrong voices, America as we know it will crumble. Even yesterday, you're hearing threats. Oh, if we try to replace this justice before the election day, we're going to burn this country and every city in it to the ground. What is right about that? In any case, every time enough informed individuals who've learned from the past choose to take a stand and to go against the crowd by doing what is right, I'll tell you, I'm honest, I believe that a day of reckoning is pushed back. The Lord gives us more time. If my people, remember, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sins. I'll heal their land. To do that a little longer, and more people can be saved, the kingdom of God will grow as the team comes. I encourage you to examine all sides of an issue before jumping to a conclusion and possibly making a serious mistake. I'm encouraging young people. Watch a little bit of news and then take some notes and say, I'm going to focus on this one issue. Just take one issue. I'm going to focus on it. I'm going to research it. My goodness. You know, it used to be whenever I was typing my sermon back there on the computer, and I'd say, oh, man, I need to know where this is. Or I've seen this somewhere. I'd have to shut everything down, you know, and then do a hunt, and go look through a bunch of books where I think I saw. Now all you have to do is just take your phone and go, where is such and such? You can find research that quickly. Write something down. I want to know the truth about this. I want to understand what BLM really means. What does it really stand for? What is their motto? What is their mantra? What does it really mean? Look it up, and you'll be going, oh my goodness. You talk about Antichrist. Look it up. A lot of people that are preaching today, they have no idea what it means. They don't know what they're doing because they haven't studied it. I encourage you, examine both sides of an issue before jumping to a conclusion. Here's some historical truth. God loves you.
Amen.
He looked down from on high, he saw us in our messed up condition, and he did something about it. He still loved us enough, he put on skin, and he came to earth in the form of a man, in the form of Jesus Christ, a genuine historical figure. The Jewish Roman historian Josephus, he saw Jesus, and he says, he is the Messiah. After he was crucified, he said, he was the Messiah. He still is. He still is. He lived a sinless life, but was sentenced to die by sinful man. And he died at a point in history when Romans had come up with the most horrific form of death ever designed. And if he'd come today, lethal injection, that would have been much suffering. Maybe a little mental anguish. But Jesus died the most horrific death ever on the cross to pay for our sins, proving he alone could do it by rising again on the third day. Amen?
Amen.
He conquered death. So to everyone who believes that he did that for them, Jesus offers eternal life. And no need to fear your personal day of reckoning. If you would, bow your head with me. There is right and there is wrong. Considering both sides, do you believe Jesus is who he claims to be? If you have decided to trust Jesus as your Savior, I encourage you to pray with me now. Again, it's not the prayer that saves you, it's the attitude of the heart. Make these words mean something. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I've done some things that are wrong in my life. I'm sorry. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. And you proved that you could do that by rising again on the third day. Nobody else ever did that. Lord, come into my life. Help me to live for you. Give me a home in heaven when I die. Thank you for saving me. Now, without looking around, even those of you at home, if you did that, if you're not involved in a church somewhere, you go get to one, you get to a local church that teaches this Bible, that teaches the truth, and you get involved with that church family. When you're weak, when you're run down, or something. That's what a family is for. When one is down or one is hurting or one is sick, the rest of the family are there to help them. The devil is a roaring lion, and the Bible says he seeks those he may devour. The lions and the tigers, they track down those that have gotten away from the flock, the sick, the weak, the alone, and they bring them down. Stay involved. Stay with the family. Stay with the church. Stay with the flock. If you pray to receive the Lord, I'm going to encourage you to see this phone number that's on your screen, to contact us, email, leave a message, let us know that you've prayed that prayer, or that you would like to talk with somebody about your decision. Now we're going to close the service with this song.
Let's stand together as we sing this last song. It's like we started the service. Thank you. is our declaration this morning. We need you. We need you every hour. We need you. Father, forgive us for living our lives thinking we can do this on our own. Jesus himself said, without me, you can do nothing. But thank you that through you, we can do all things. Help us to live our lives this week in total, complete, utter faith.